and then the Holy Spirit answers him. This is one of those. And I pray that as we seek the Lord in prayer, we will also at the same time wait for an answer and receive one. Instruction as to exactly what to do. So I pray that we would hear clearly, get direct instructions in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we have one more week after this with the man of God who has been blessing us. I think kind of this week I was thinking a lot about what we heard last Sunday about how culture really affects how we function. And I think what really fascinated me the most was the fact that when you are in trouble or when things are not going as well as you want, you tend to go back to your culture, or whether you enter a place that looks different, you go back to your culture. That really shows us how much our culture, plays a huge impact in our lives. We're praying and hoping that the culture of being a Christian will permeate our lives a little bit more than the culture of our various countries. Because sometimes the culture of being in Christ conflicts with the culture of our villages and towns and cities. For example, in the place of marriage, somebody may feel, well, you know, I only want to marry somebody from my village. Well, that's not scripture. That's contrary to scripture. Scripture says, marry somebody who is born again.
Marry several people from my village.
You got to marry somebody who is saved. Yeah, it's not about whether they were what color. You know, it's interesting that Paul, in his instruction right there, didn't put color in it. And he didn't say they must come from your town. Praise God. Anyway, let's rise to our feet then and welcome the ministry of Matthew Porter. Praise God.
The first week we talked about diversity and unity. And the bit at this end. Now, if I've got ideas, or the gospel, you guys with gospel, and you're wanting to cross over into a new land, into a new place, God calls, the scripture and the normal dictionary calls this end and this end the bridgehead. It's a funnel where all the stuff has to come onto the bridge. Come over and onto the new land. So usually a bridge is over the river. The river is the boundary. The river is blocking you. And the bridge, solid, strong, is what's going to take you. And the bridgehead, so all your resources get focused here and they come across and then they spread out into the new place. And strangely, I don't quite know why, but both ends are called a bridgehead. Great, thank you very much. At this end,
Now, if I've got ideas or the gospel, you guys with gospel, and you're wanting to cross over into a new land, into a new place, God called, the scripture and the normal dictionary called this end and this end a bridgehead. It's a funnel where all the stuff has to come onto the bridge, come over, and onto the new land. So usually a bridge is over the river. The river is the boundary. The river is blocking you, and the bridge, is what's going to take you. And the bridgehead. So all your resources get focused here, and they come across, and then they spread out into the new place. And strangely, I don't quite know why, but both ends are called a bridgehead. Great, thank you very much. I'm very grateful, Joel. Thank you.
So today I want to share with you some important, significant things about the spiritual information about this land that you find yourself in, that you're reaching, you're wanting to cross over and expand into, you're wanting to reach, and that you've already started doing that. And if you're going to do that, we do need more love, more power, don't we?
Yeah.
We do need. Where's Charlene gone? Where's she gone? She's gone up. She's come. No? Oh, yes, here she is. More love, more power is what we need. And I'd like to offer you to develop that song. More love, more power, more of you in this land. And verse 1 and verse 2 is very much, I will worship you.
Yeah.
What about making it we will worship you? Because to have more love, more power, and to be effective across this bridge, the bridgehead, it needs to be we. It needs to be family. Because I have to tell you, this is no longer the age, no longer the season of the one-man ministry. This is no longer the time where you can put a big spiritual man on a platform and people will just come. Because they don't. Everyone who's coming, who's going to come to church is already coming. They are already coming. So we need to be reaching people with the gospel where they are. Church attendance in this land dropped off for two main reasons. The first was a loss of hope from the two world wars, when hundreds of thousands of people didn't ever come back. And tens of thousands of people in East London died because the bombs rained out of the sky and there's nothing you can do about it. The despair of just being, it's just random, is how it felt. So this, some of the certainties of the gospel were lost. The other thing that saw a drop off in church attendance was all to do with, well, two sides of the same thing. One was increase in technology and an increase in finance. So by technology, I don't mean mobile phones, I mean the invention of public transport. So in the 1920s, something called the charabanc, the first, if you like, the buses, were able to take people out to the countryside, out to Epping Forest. And people never hadn't really been. So they'd go on a Sunday, because all the other days they're working. And then cinema got invented. Now we feel like cinema's always been here, but it hasn't.
Be a bridge for me. Just put your arms right out like a bridge. Bridge is very solid, very strong, isn't it? Yes, I am very strong. Now, a bridge head
is not the physical bridge. A bridgehead is the bit at this end and the bit at this end. Now, if I've got ideas, or the gospel, you guys with the gospel, and you're wanting to cross over into a new land, into a new place, God calls, the scripture and the normal dictionary calls this end and this end the bridgehead. It's a funnel where all the stuff has to come onto the bridge, to come over, and onto the new land. So usually a bridge is over the river. The river is the boundary, the river's blocking you, and the bridge, solid, strong, is what's going to take you. And the bridgehead, so all your resources get focused here and they come across and then they spread out into the new place. And strangely, I don't quite know why, but both ends are called a bridgehead. Great, thank you very much.
So today I want to share with you some important, significant things about the spiritual information about this land that you find yourself in, that you're reaching, you're wanting to cross over and expand into, you're wanting to reach, and that you've already started doing that. And if you're going to do that, we do need more love, more power, don't we?
Yeah.
We do need. Where's Charlene gone? Where's she gone? She's gone up. She's come. No? Oh, yes, here she is. More love, more power is what we need. And I'd like to offer you to devote. More love, more power, more of you in this land. And verse 1 and verse 2 is very much, I will worship you.
Yeah.
What about making it we? We will worship you. Because to have more love, more power, and to be effective across this bridge, the bridgehead, it needs to be we. It needs to be family. Because I have to tell you, this is no longer the age, no longer the season of the one-man ministry. This is no longer the time where you can put a big spiritual man on a platform and people will just come. Because they don't. Everyone who's coming, who's going to come to church is already coming. They are already coming. So we need to be reaching people with the gospel where they are. Church attendance in this land dropped off for two main reasons. The first was a loss of hope from the two world wars, when hundreds of thousands of people didn't ever come back. And tens of thousands of people in East London died because the bombs rained out of the sky and there's nothing you can do about it. The despair of just being, it's just random, is how it felt. So this, some of the certainties of the gospel were lost. The other thing that saw a drop off in church attendance was all to do with, well, two sides of the same thing. One was increase in technology and an increase in finance. So by technology, I don't mean mobile phones, I mean the invention of public transport. So in the 1920s, something called the Sharabank, the first, if you like, the buses, were able to take people out to the countryside, out to Epping Forest. And people never hadn't really been. So they go on a Sunday, because all the other days they're working. And then cinema got invented. Now we feel like cinema's always been here, but it hasn't. Again, the 1920s, cinema was invented, so people, ooh, look, shiny, shiny, this is nice. which tells you that lots of people used to go to church because it was the only thing happening. It was the only thing that happened on a Sunday. And so as more things became available, people went off and did those things. And so we need to be where people are. So it's always dangerous to say this in front of a church leader, but Sunday morning isn't the focus of the week. It's a filling station. It's a place to be together. And the work of God goes on out there. I went to a building yesterday, the Salvation Army in Stratford, which was that way. And over the door going out, the last door, so you're going out to the street, it said, "You are now entering a place of worship." And I thought that was fantastic. Never seen it before. Thought it was brilliant. Anyway, I'll start, shall I? That's a little aside. Just remind me, wave at me if you live in Newham. Excellent. And wave at me if you live in Plaistow. I don't live in Plaistow. Not many people. Right. Okay. So this is now where I want to go today is about Newham and about Plaistow. This is information in a time of war. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Psalm 24 verse 1. He made it all. And Genesis chapter 1 verse 2 tells us that he made it good. So Newham is good. Are you with me? Oh, I've been here long enough. Can I get a bit African? Let's say it together. Newham is good. Now, lots of people and lots of messages from the press try to tell you the opposite of that. But the Lord has made every molecule beneath our feet, every cell in your body, God has made, and it's good. So Newham is good. Why is our borough like it is? How did it get to be like this? Now, this has got to be very quick. I'm in a group of four of us, and we've spent, I've been with them 8 years, and some of them have been doing it longer, to say, why is Newham like it is? I've got 20 minutes to try and distill some of that. A way into that, first of all, is to say, what are the purposes of this land of Newham? First one I want to offer you is this. This land of Newham was designed or developed, rather, that's the best verb, was developed to serve the centre of London, what's called the City of London. 200 years ago, the postcodes that we talk about now, so Forest Gate, Plaistow, Manor Park, were tiny, tiny little villages. No more than 2,000 people in all of Newham. It's countryside, basically. And everything from the Barking, south of the Barking Road was marsh. The tide would come up and flood it. Everything south of the Barking Road was marsh. That people would just graze their cattle on it. If you weren't careful, the cattle would get washed away. Tun Marsh Lane. People driven along it? Tun Marsh Lane. A tun is a barrel. So it was enough water to float barrels along Tun Marsh Lane. It just sounds completely nuts now, doesn't it? 200 years ago is not a long time. There were a few manor houses, really, starting from here, going north. A few manor houses dotted around. And this is where London comes in, for wealthy Londoners who didn't want to live in the smoke and with the dirty people. I want to live in the countryside. Kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? oh, I don't want to live in Grotty Newham. I want to live in the countryside of Havering or Hornchurch. I'm moving out. That's right. So, do you hear that? Josiah's recognizing something in the land. Now, whether he understands it with the front of his mind, something in his spirit is recognizing the truth of that. Posh Londoners built manor houses. Okay. Then market gardens grew up. Newham was covered with food, growing food for London. Second half of the 19th century, along the River Lee, they've made a whole load of abattoirs and industry. Not because there were loads of people here. They'd walk all the cattle and the geese. You'd have geese and cattle and sheep walking across Newham to get to the River Lee, where they'd be slaughtered and then taken the one day's journey into London. Then, in sort of early middle of the 19th century, the River Lee, which is this way, Thames along the bottom, and the other side is the River Roding. Three rivers, do you know Newham's bounded by tidal water? And then across the top is the forest. That's why Newham has such a cohesive sense to it. The borders are very strong. Those rivers were given concrete embankments, so the water had to stay where it was told to go. And that really, for the first time, meant that this could be proper land. Or everything up to Barking Road used to be called the Plaistow Levels. And then you put concrete in the rivers to make the embankments. And so then gradually, the south of Newham could drain and become real land. And into that land, almost straight away, came the docks and the railways. So these were massive investments by people with money uptown in London. Why did they do it? For the villagers here? No. To make more money. Early capitalism, unrestrained capitalism. Nobody knows how many men died digging the docks. But I bet my boots it was a huge number. Trade, empire, Freemasonry, monarchy, all went out to the world from Newham through these docks. The gasworks at Beckton were the biggest in the world when they were made. Gas, it's called the Gas, Light and Coke Company. Founded by a guy called Simon Adams Beck. Where do you think it was? Beckton. Beck's town. Beckton means Beck's town. Now, if you're powerful enough to have the land named after you, you are a fairly powerful person. And in the 19th century, you didn't get powerful by being kind. You got powerful by being mean and loaded with money and using people to get more money. So this Gas, Coke and Light Company, where did it supply the gas to? Back into the city. A modern day hero of mine is a guy called Joseph Bazalgette. In 1864, he made the first sewage system in the world, in London. Now, who's been on their bike down the Greenway? Me? Me? Or walking? Walking? What is the Greenway, actually? It's on the top of the northern outfall sewer. The sewer bank. I heard people call it the sewer bank. Bazalgette made that 1864 to take poo from London. Yes, yes, that's right. It's full of posh people's poo. It still is. It still is. Yes, she's going.
Oh no!
Now, eventually, the local areas, sewage, A, got dug and B, connected to it. But first of all, local people, there was no sewage, it was outside running down the streets. But the posh people's poo was taken out of London. Now, the blessing of that, all of these things bring blessing to London. The blessing of that is that there was no more cholera. The sewage system stopped cholera forever in London. Hundreds of thousands, probably by now millions of lives saved. And once people kind of clocked it here, they then said, oh, perhaps it's to do with that. We're linking those two things. And so sewage systems become how we build cities. So the first key purpose of this land has been to serve London, the centre. I haven't got time to talk about whether the centre's been faithful in serving here or leading gently with humility and kindness. I think that's a several cup of coffee conversation. The second purpose of Newham is to welcome people. Land takes its character from what people do on it repeatedly. And that's, again, we could go through Genesis and all parts of the New Testament to demonstrate this, but this is about where land and where man and the angels and God are in the created order. But in this world's economy, God put man in charge, and so what man does on the land repeatedly invests the land with character. And where we are now in time is this character is now sort of oozing back out of the land. It rises up, and the air we breathe takes on some of the character of the land. Second purpose of Newham is to welcome people. This land is a place of welcome, supposed to be. The docks would not have got dug from the few people who lived here. It got dug by people who came from overseas, from Ireland. The railways got laid, not by local people, but by, again, people from outside of the area, mainly Ireland, but other places too, to lay the railways. So if you do, then the docks operate, people come on a boat, get off the boat and say, I'm now in London and I'll settle here. And then succeeding generations have come to docks areas because people that I know are already here. I'm going to huddle. Do you remember last week about huddling by people like me, people like us, the same food, same language, same clothes, same ways of worship? I get off the docks and I stay there. I've come in this weird land. I found a few people like me. Oh, whew, great. I'll stay here. And that's why East London is so multicultural. Airports are a very recent invention. We're pleased for them if we want to travel somewhere. But they are very recent. Really, the docks and the River Thames, they are the docks are the front door, and the River Thames is the M1 for London. That's how most people, for most of history, have come into London, up the river, because it's tidal. Did you know the Thames, twice a day, the rivers go up and down, and they go up and down more than the height of this room? Between 21 and 25 feet is the tidal range in Newham. If you stick your finger in it, it's a bit mucky, but lick it, it's salt. The sea, we are a coastal city. The sea comes up. And that's how most people, for most of the time, have come here. Now, today, where you live today, what about today? Matthew, you're a historian, shut up about that. What about today? Two new waves of people are moving in. The uptown professionals, who are still able to buy in Newham, unlike most of us, they're still able to buy. So they've been renting in Hoxton and Hackney and are now moving to Newham. And one of the things that's interesting about that is that they're very multicultural. So for the first time in a long time, there are some white people moving in instead of just moving out. But they're I've got a friend, he's in his late 20s, just got married to he's white, he's married to a Nigerian woman, and they are the new London. They are this uptown, professional, multicultural couple. Just bought, settling down. The other wave of people are Chinese business people. They're all going to arrive in 2018 on Albert Dock. You know, there's going to be a great big place of business for Far Eastern companies. And so, these two new waves of people coming in, what welcome will they receive? This is supposed to be a place of welcome. It hasn't always done it very well, but we can play a part in the purposes of this land, the purposes that God has created Plaistow and Newham for. Okay, that's part one. Part two, now I want to move now and share with you some spiritual truths about Plaistow. And this is, if you don't get it all, let go of the stuff. Preachers don't normally say this. If you don't get it, doesn't matter. Just hang on to the bits that land with you. Plaistow is landlocked in Newham. It's the only postcode that doesn't touch the edge. So it's the heart of Newham. Plaistow is the heart of Newham. So this is a picture of the docks. And I was just talking about the Chinese coming to Albert Dock, which is just down here. It's empty land at the moment, but they're starting to put diggers on it. So Plaistow really starts just at the very top and goes north. Plaistow is the heart of Newham. And there's a hole in this heart. There's light and darkness in Plaistow, in the land, because of what people have done in the past. Let's do the light stuff first, because we are followers of Christ's light. Christians have been in Plaistow for hundreds and hundreds of years. John Wesley preached here, George Whitfield preached here. And this particular area, I said to you before, on the Barking Road and Balham Street, has the densest focus of Christian ministries in the borough. Still today. Now this building that we're in, hello, come on in. This building was originally called the West Ham Central Mission. It was finished in 1922. If you can follow this. What happened at the beginning? What happened not only on the land but in buildings? What's the commission of a building that gives it character and vision and commission from God? And here's the commission for this building that you're gathering in, you're worshipping, you're identifying with. It was built to be a great cathedral church towering over the mean streets of South West Ham Borough, witnessing to the love of God and, oh, here's that word, welcoming people to a house of beauty and peace, people who are burdened and have weary hearts. Thank you for that, amen. So, it aims to minister into the area to poor, downtrodden, crushed families who are working in the docks and E13. Is that true today in this building? Well, yes, it is actually. There's downstairs food for homeless. Just as we were coming in and saying, what do we do? Food for homeless people. Yesterday, 70 breakfasts for homeless people. There's, which way? This way, there's flats for elderly people. Where else would they live? There's a ministry in this building called Survivors, which is about men and women who experience sexual abuse in childhood, who have found each other and are drawing strength and encouragement and learning to walk out some of their healing. And they're very realistic and say, we ain't gonna get to that place as if it never happened. But we are journeying, travelling together. There's something called the WAFCAF, which helps refugees and new arrivals get involved by bringing the skills they already have, which is around cooking. I've arrived in the country with almost nothing, but I have my experience and I have my skills and a place where they can do what they're about and contribute, make a difference. There's alternatives. Now, in the last week, Alternatives out the back has just got being able to buy its building. It was in grave danger of being sold and being knocked down. But Alternatives is run by Christians as a crisis pregnancy advice place. Every year, women who find themselves pregnant, unplanned, come in desperation, some referred from Newham General Hospital, where the only offer there is abortion. They come and receive hope instead of despair. And if they choose to keep their baby, there's ongoing support. And for some, there's housing as well. That is seriously good news. There's an art gallery as well that functions here in this building. And when you've walked in, have you ever looked at those stones on the way in, the white ones that are at around sort of chest height? All this work has been enabled by money, missionary money, if you like, sent by other places in the country and other places right around the world here. Now, some of you have come from right around the world here. And we said a couple of weeks ago, you're missionaries. Of the divine compassion. Now, that's a bit of a mouthful, but can you hear in it? No, it basically, divine compassion basically means God's love and care. See how that fits with the mandate of this building? God's love and care, practical, applied. And so all these things are here about giving you clues about God's heart for here and how to minister. If you're going to cross this bridge, how can you do it effectively rather than with wasted time and effort? Yes, yeah, so this building's been replaced, but all of this was part of West Ham Central Mission, and where the NHS is now, that's still run by West Ham Central Mission. Massive, isn't it? It's been a Cathedral is about the right word. Massive installation of God's love. Now, this hole in the heart that of Newham that Plaistow bears, I want to finish up talking about some of this, and this is the lairiest stuff, really. The land is defiled. Besides poverty, the grinding poverty that forces people to steal. 100 years ago, a guy said, "When I'm hungry, it makes me an anarchist because I'm so hungry. I've got to steal or break something to steal something, to sell it to get food." Poverty, very oppressive for lots of people in this land. There have been broken promises from those with power up top. Major finances in Plaistow have gone missing over, certainly in the 20th century. Lots of money has gone missing. And here's interestingly, it's gone missing in churches. People have run off with the cash in churches in Plaistow. In Plaistow there's been sexual sin at an institutional level. Leaders have fallen, and especially bizarrely in Plaistow among church leaders. White, African, Asian church leaders, those who were born here, those who have arrived here, have all left their ministry after falling into sexual sin. But it wasn't, and that wasn't just about having an affair with someone in the congregation, though that's bad enough, but it's been about wrong expressions of power and control when people were dehumanized, abused, and trust was radically broken. In Plaistow, too, children in the system, particularly children with disabilities, have got abused, destroyed, and forgotten. Now, all these things in the 20th and 21st century end up hooking into the ancient idolatry that's happened on this land. It's happened on this land for thousands of years. Now, some of this will sound very familiar to some of you. Ancestor worship, use of sex in worship and fertility cults, nature worship, water spirits, Leviathan. Now, there have always been nature worshippers on this land in Plaistow. Trees, rocks, rivers, particularly the rivers, the great river. People have been throwing in the Bronze Age, all along from central London really down to Galleon's Reach, really full of lots of offerings. There have been a few human sacrifices uncovered in Newham. And what are they? Children with disabilities. And there are witch doctors still operating in Newham. Have you had the cards, the marabouts? Now, if anyone ends up wanting to do something about that, I've been collecting them for 12 years. I've got a list of 100. Names, addresses, phone numbers from those cards. So I record it, log it, destroy it. It just tells you this Everybody wants to worship on this land. It's very, very faithful. Mosques now, and that number has come from the police. So those are buildings. Plus all the informal ones. But what does all this mean for our bridgehead? What does it mean? How do we live in the face of these ancient wells of idolatrous worship? How do we live? We live in the opposite of that. We live in the opposite spirit, in the Holy Spirit of God. We follow Jesus radically. And obedience is, in this land, obedience is spiritual warfare. In terms of the sexual sin and the theft in churches, we have to clean house. We have to repent. Cover yourselves and your leaders, church. Cover yourselves. Pray for protection. Pray for your leaders. And then don't sit in judgment, because that's a major, major thing that the enemy sneaks in the back door of Christians, is judgment. What we have to do is identify and say, but for the grace of God, there go I. And so you have to identify and then pray for and repent on their behalf. Live wisely and live generously. So that's the first point, how we're going to live. Second point, how we're going to live when we're doing outreach on the patch. Speak to this land, would you? Jeremiah 22:29 says, O land, 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 hear the word of the Lord. Awake. When you do outreach on this patch in Newham, how do you do it? If you still got your Bibles, would you turn with me to Isaiah chapter 40? Because this is so important on this land. I can't talk about Bolton, I can't talk about Southend, but I have been entrusted with some things about this land, and this is how you do outreach on this land. Isaiah 40 says, comfort my people, says your God. Just to make sure you get who it's coming from, comfort my people. Margaret is doing counselling, very highly qualified, speaking comfort to people. Pastor Boomy in Florence last week, talking with Andrew, comfort my people, practically, carefully. Be nice to people. Verse 2 says, speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service is completed. Now that means the land of Jerusalem, because we've already done the people in the verse before. Speak to the land tenderly, because the land is abused. Now, maybe you have to invite Margaret in the future to talk about how this approach of tenderly and gently to people who are abused. Learn gentleness. It's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. The third way of being effective in your bridgehead into this land is to serve the brokenhearted. Again, just turn over to Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me. We all want that, don't we? We sang, more love, more power. Inviting the Holy Spirit to be in us and through us. Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me. Hooray, we say, great. This is what I want. To preach, hooray, we all believe in that. But where? Good news, yes, the good news of Jesus. To who? The poor. Oh, that's a bit more uncomfortable. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. People and the land are brokenhearted. Freedom for the captives. difficulties. People are feeling bound by poverty. Release from darkness for the prisoners. People are feeling imprisoned by the enemy activity in their lives down through their generations. Deliverance. The year of the Lord's favor is here. So finally, please speak blessing to people in the land. When you speak a blessing, that undermines the devil's schemes. Did you know that? Because the enemy is about binding people. It is about darkness, prison, captive, broken. What does the devil come to do? Kill, steal, and destroy. Do the opposite, would you? Be the opposite for people, would you? And each other? Tenderly, gently. You don't have to know all the specifics of God's purposes for a piece of land or for a person to bless them. We know his purpose is to bless with his presence. He wants to be present in every place, in every person, all the time. Just speak a blessing. And that will gradually undermine the permission in the land and in people's lives that the devil has. And you will then be effective in your outreach. You will be good news. You won't be wasting time and effort. You will be effective. And you will grow in the fruits and the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Lord God, we do want to be effective with and in and for you. Help us, please, to be strategic. Help us to be tactical in who and how and where and when we speak, what we speak, what we do. To serve the brokenhearted, help us to find out what that means, possibly joining things that are already happening in this building, or joining with others amongst us here who've got a passion to do something new. Lord, we bless each other. We bless this land, this building, Plaistow, in your name, Lord God. We want to learn to cooperate with you about speaking and being a blessing that all people around us may be blessed. Amen.
I remember a woman from Nigeria who I was told was having a go because the ambulance did not come on time. I laughed. You go to your country and go call an ambulance. She's complaining, talking down the same service she wants to eat from. And I remember I've said to us many times, you cannot speak against this land and then eat from it. No, that doesn't work. You can never speak against what you want and hope you will get it. That doesn't work. If you want to make love to your wife in the evening, from 5 a.m., I know what I'm talking about. By the time you look outside and it's 5 a.m., you start talking. You better say the right things. Watch your step. See what she likes. Take out the bins. Keep the kitchen nice and tidy.
Yes.
Right, God only knows what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah.
Otherwise, you get nothing in the evening. N.I.C.C. has a way of relating with sex very well. So I think you've got it now. You understand now. When I use husband and wife, you need to understand. So now you understand. So we need to think about, when we're talking about starting a ministry, it's about giving back.
That's right.
you're sowing, and you will reap. You will reap. I truly believe that even some of us that need our stay regularized, I really believe, I mean, this is just me, I believe that you can do so much for this land that everybody would fight for you to get your papers.
That's right.
Because I've seen it in one brother's life. Because of his contribution to society, everybody in the neighborhood wrote letters that he needs to stay here because we need him. So let's think about giving back, not just taking. Amen?
Amen.
So let's also give to our church right now. Praise God. Amen.